Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship at Resto Valley Community Church. My name is Howard. I'm the pastor here. I'm not Philip, I'm not my brother, because that's what my kids thought when after I shaved my beard. They all said I looked like Saisok, which is my brother. So I am your pastor. sorry, it was a little late. Someone needed a Band-Aid, and we had just gotten two medical kits. And so we just need to mount them up, but that's one of the announcements I'd like to share, is that we have medical kits. We're gonna put one somewhere in the kitchen, somewhere downstairs for the kids. Another announcement is that Sissel has an announcement. Thank you, Sissel. So next Sunday in fellowship hall during the Sunday school hour, Sissel will share a little bit more about how the gospel is making its way through all the nations, including the different countries that Sissel has been visiting, one in particular next week. Are there any other announcements? Mike, welcome.
Thank you all for your prayers and your support. I'm here because of prayer, mercy, and grace. Mm. A lot of mercy. The knee replacement was fine. Complications after that, put me in the hospital for a while, and I'm still in the woods from that. So keep praying, please. Mm. Thank you.
So good to see you and Joan here together. Well, we're here because we worship God. He's called us, and every one of us at one point in time have said, I am a sinner. You have identified yourself as a sinner, and you're here because you also, by God's grace, recognize that apart from the gospel of Jesus Christ, there is no hope. But we're here not because we're perfect. We're here because God desires to show mercy and grace and love, and to remind us of what He's done and what He plans to do, to show us how He does love us. That's why we worship Him. So let's prepare our hearts for worship.
We'll open our time of worship together here this morning with a word from Psalm 15, and to get our hearts in tune with God here this morning. Psalm 15, O Lord, who shall sojourn in your tent? Who shall dwell on your holy hill? He who walks blamelessly and does what is right and speaks truth in his heart, who does not slander with his tongue and does no evil to his neighbor, nor takes up a reproach against his friend, in whose eyes a vile person is despised, but who honors those who fear the Lord, who swears to his own hurt and does not change, who does not put out his money at interest and does not take a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things shall never be moved. Let's open with prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this blessed day that you've given us, Lord, this first day of the week where we come to give you the first of ourselves. God, before we take off to work or activities or school or whatever we have ahead of us this week, Lord, we come and dedicate ourselves to worshiping you here in this first hour of our week. God, we thank you for the great privilege and opportunity to come before you and to raise up your holy name. And God, may our worship today be pleasing and glorifying unto you. Lord, may our hearts and our minds and our ears be opened to receive your word. God, may the prayers that we issue today, the songs that we sing, the things that we pray about and the meditations that we have in our hearts today be glorifying and pleasing unto you and fully aligned with your perfect and holy will. Lord, we pray all these things as we begin our worship service here this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, please stand and we'll be called to worship this morning. Every generous act of giving is a tribute to God's love for us. Lord, let us be people of generous and abundant gifts for others. Be ready to listen and slow to react in anger. Lord, prepare us to be peaceful people. Keep your hearts and spirits ready to serve the Lord. Lord, open our hearts to hear and respond to your words of life in ministries of hope and peace. Amen. Please remain standing. We'll sing our first hymn this morning. It is, I Will Sing of My Redeemer. Amen. You may be seated. We'll go into our time of prayer together this morning, and as we do, we always begin with our prayer of confession, and we have a couple of scriptures for our call to confession and assurance of pardon today. Call to confession this morning will be from the Gospel of Mark, And this is chapter 7, verses 1 through 8. Now, when the Pharisees gathered to him, being Jesus, with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of his disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands properly, holding to the tradition of the elders, and when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other traditions that they observe, such as the washing of cups and pots and copper vessels and dining couches. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" And he said to them, "Well did Isaiah prophesy of you, hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men.' You leave the commandment of God and hold to the tradition of men." Let us pray silently together, and then we'll pray together as a church. Let us all pray together now. God, you who are truth, you who dwell within me, you see me as I am, and you receive me as I am. Help me to shed all attachment to outward appearances, to see myself truthfully, and to let myself be filled from the inside out. With your grace, your forgiveness, your blessing, your love. Amen. Hear this assurance of pardon from the letter of James, chapter 12. And this is, chapter 1. This is verses 17 through 25. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your soul. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. And we know that through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the strength that we get from our Savior is the only strength that we have to enable us to do these things that the Word calls us to. And it's only through Jesus and only through the power of the Spirit can we ever hope to attain to this level of goodness and mercy. But through Jesus, thanks to him, our sinful souls are forgiven. Hallelujah and amen. Well, please stand. We'll sing our second hymn this morning. This is Great is Thy Faithfulness, and it's number 60 in the hymnal. Amen. You may be seated. We'll continue our time of prayer together this morning with the prayers of the people, where we bring before God the things that are on our hearts, burdens, thankfulness, all the things that we have going on in our lives. God welcomes us and gives us this great privilege of connecting with Him in prayer. And I said it a few weeks ago, it was a great statement that I heard from Alistair Begg. He said, "We don't know what God's perfect will is, but we know that it involves our prayers." And every prayer is important to God. So let us go now before God in prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank You for this awesome gift of prayer, where You welcome us in. You draw us close to You. You allow us, Lord, to be part of Your great, perfect, and holy will. And Lord, in our small minds, we can't grasp all the things that You are doing and all the ways that You work. Because, Lord, your will and your power and your majesty, Lord, are just too mysterious for us to understand. But, God, we trust You. We know You as our Father. And, Lord, You call us into this relationship with prayer. And so, Lord, as we come to You this morning and we bring You our thankfulness, we bring You our burdens, we bring You those people who are on our hearts, Lord, who need Your help. God, we come before You as Your children here today. Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, I want to start by lifting up Jim and Katie. Lord, as they're at home now with COVID, and they're having to fight COVID off. Katie had enough problems already trying to get through our cancer treatments. And Lord, we just pray for Your health to fill them, Lord, that they would be made well, that they would recover quickly, and Lord, that Your healing power would be in their home and in their bodies working day and night, Lord, to bring them back to perfect health. Lord, we just continue to lift up Katie and ask that You continue to strengthen her and rid her body of the cancer, Lord, and that these drugs and medical procedures and processes, Lord, would just work through Your mighty healing power. Lord, we thank You and give You Jim and Katie as our brothers and sisters in Christ, Lord, that You would take them and heal them. Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we do thank You for a successful and safe trip to Mongolia and back for Sissel and for her team. And God, we just thank You for what You were able to accomplish, Lord, in just this short time that they were gone. We thank You for providing safe travels there and back. We thank You, Lord, that the seed of Your word has been planted in new areas. And God, we just thank You for even the surprises that came up, Lord, that were completely unexpected. Lord, we thank You. Thank You for enabling this to happen. And Lord, we just pray that Your word would take root in that region and that many would come to believe on the strong and mighty name of Jesus. Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, I also want to just give You a big thanks for answered prayer today. Lord, as we see our brother Mike Wilson sitting in the pew with us here after he's been out for so long and been through so much difficulty. And we know, Lord, he has some road ahead of him. But God, how great You are. How great You are to have brought him this far and to be here with us today, Lord. It is just a, It is just a mighty, mighty joy in our hearts to see Mike here with us. And we thank you. We thank you for all that you've brought him through, for the healing that you have worked in his body. Lord, thank you for this great technology that you have provided us with, that his knee is brand new and will never wear out again. And God, we just lift him and Joan up to you, that you just continue to help them, strengthen them, guide them, and protect them, Lord, as Mike continues to regain his strength. And Lord, we just again thank you and bless your holy name for what you have done in this life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we do lift up Heidi's family as her son Sam goes to be wed to his fiance in Alaska this week. Lord, we just pray for a good wedding. Lord, we pray for good weather for them, and God, that you would just bless this time of their family together. Lord, we pray that those who don't know you and who don't believe in you today might come to faith as a result of going to this wedding. And God, we just pray that your spirit would be present at the ceremony with this family, and Lord, that your Holy Spirit would speak to hearts as this goes on. Lord, we pray for a long and happy marriage to Sam and his future wife, and Lord, we just pray that their hearts would draw, as they draw close to each other in this marriage, Lord, that they would draw close to you as well. And God, that you would bless them and draw them in, and that they would know you as their Savior and Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we do lift up the Hafers, and we thank you, Lord, for this successful process of adoption as they now have a new daughter. And God, we just pray for this entire family, that you bless them, that you help them, Lord, as they take on this young life into their own and bring her into their home. And Lord, that your spirit would be there, and that this young girl would never know a day apart from her Lord, Jesus Christ. Lord, be with them and bless them. Fill them with your Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Well, Heavenly Father, you've heard these prayers, both spoken and unspoken. And Lord, we just thank you, God, that we can be confident that every prayer uttered, that from our hearts or from our mouths, is heard by your great and powerful ear. Lord, that you love us. You love us with a love that is beyond anything that we can understand. And Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, and we love you. We are so grateful to have you as our great and heavenly Father. Lord, we lift up those who could not be with us here today. If they're traveling, Lord, we just pray that you keep them safe and bring them home safely and soundly. Lord, if they're sick, we pray for healing and restoration, Lord, of their health. And God, we just continue to lift up those who are outside of these walls, taking care of us and protecting us, the police forces, the sheriff's department, or the military, all those who are defending our borders. God, we thank you for these brave men and women who take on these dangerous and hazardous jobs for the sake of serving your people here on this earth. We pray for the missionaries, Lord, who are out across this world sharing the gospel even today, even right now as we sit here together. And they are in areas where the gospel is not welcomed and actually is considered criminal in some places. And God, we just pray for your protection over them. We pray for your great bounty of resources to flow into these people's lives and ministries, Lord, that they can continue this great call that you have put upon their hearts to do. And we just lift up these missionaries, the pastors who are preaching this morning around this world. God, just fill them with your Holy Spirit, and may their words accurately reflect what you desire for people's hearts to be hearing this morning. Even with Howard, God, we just pray for Howard as he steps up here and takes your word and brings it to us here today, Lord. Fill his heart with your Holy Spirit. Fill him with your wisdom and your strength and your peace as he does this great deed of expounding your word to your people. God, we are so grateful to be here, so grateful to be your church. And Lord, we lift our voices up together as one, praying in the way that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Amen. Let's continue our worship with our tithes and offerings. Let's stand and praise God together. We praise you, Father, for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, this brief life that you've given us to steward. And I pray as we give back the resources you've given us, we pray that it would be used mightily by the Spirit, by your Spirit in and through your church, both gathered and scattered out into the world that you've loved and you continue to love. May your love be shown forth through the proclamation of your gospel, or the relationships that would point ultimately to the love of Christ, God. For we all need it deeply and urgently. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Excuse the congestion. I don't think I'm sick, but it's exactly what happened last year where I got sick from Tommy because of my immunosuppression medication. I have an immune system of a three-year-old. So I don't think I'm sick, but because of that, asthma, allergies. But the carpet I'm standing on, because it's new, I can guarantee you it's not the dust mites here. So I thank everyone for the, I thank God through y'all that I'm standing on mercy right now. This morning's scripture reading comes from two different places. 1 Kings chapter 11, which kind of continues the story of Solomon. And then also, in an interesting way, Song of Songs, also in some way related to Solomon. We'll start with 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 11, you can find it on your pew Bible on page 291. The author writes, "Now King Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, and Hittite women, from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel, 'You shall not enter into marriage with them, neither shall they with you, for surely they will turn away your heart after other gods.' Solomon clung to these in love. He had 700 wives who were princesses and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For when Solomon was old, his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not wholly true to the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. So Solomon did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and didn't wholly follow the Lord as David his father had done. Then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, and for Molech, the abomination of the Ammonites, on the mountain east of Jerusalem. And so he did for all his foreign wives who made offerings and sacrificed to their gods. And the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart had turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice and had commanded him concerning this thing that he should not go after other gods, but he didn't keep what the Lord commanded. Therefore, the Lord said to Solomon, 'Since this has been your practice, and you haven't kept my covenant and my statutes that I've commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and will give it to your servant.'" And moving forward in the Bible, after Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, onto the Song of Solomon, otherwise known as the Song of Songs. Chapter 2, starting with verse 7. "I adjure you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or the does of the field, that you not stir up or awaken love until it pleases. The voice of my beloved, behold, he comes, leaping over the mountains, bounding over the hills. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Behold, there he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, looking through the lattice. My beloved speaks and says to me, 'Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. For behold, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth, the time of singing has come. And the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree ripens its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance. Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away.'" This, along with 1 Kings, is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. When I told Sarah I would be preaching from Song of Songs. She got sick. Right. And if you know a little bit about the Song of Songs, she unfortunately didn't get sick with love or drunk with love, because I was about to talk and speak and preach on the Song of Songs. Rather, I think she wanted to get sick so she could get a doctor's permission slip to miss service today, since I was preaching from Song of Songs. But I told her, well, the lectionary that we're following in our liturgy and in the sermon series, that's what the lectionary served up. So I'm gonna tackle it, not skirt Song of Songs, because I am convinced that as a member of our theological tradition, that I am commissioned to preach the whole counsel of God. Not my soapboxes, not just whatever is popular or trendy in our culture, though things do need to be addressed, but the whole counsel of God. Why Song of Songs? Well, I want to start with a quote from a pretty famous Old Testament scholar. What is this song doing in the Bible? It's called Song of Songs because, like the phrase Holy of Holies, it is the best song. It is the song of all the songs. Whatever songs you might listen to, might be in your history, in your Spotify playlist, or whatever's back home in your cassette tapes. What, especially the love songs, they are all copies, imitations, parodies of this love song found in Scripture, where there's a young man and a young woman who, to put it in rated G terms, they're really into each other. Song of Songs today has been juxtaposed, or kind of put next to each other, with 1 Kings chapter 11. There are a lot of different interpretations of, or methods of interpretation for Song of Songs. Traditionally in the Jewish culture, it is to show how God himself is committed and devoted passionately within the covenant that marriage points to in his pursuit of his people. And then Christians picked up on that idea, and it's supposed to then therefore be a picture of Christ pursuing his bride. And then on the other end of the spectrum, you have folks who interpret the Song of Songs as if it were a dating manual, or strictly rated R, erotic poetry. I'm kind of following an Old Testament professor, commentator of mine, where it's a combination of everything. Where especially when you put it up next to what we just read about Solomon, it's supposed to show you the ideal picture of what love is supposed to be like. Right? Song of Songs is put next to books like Proverbs and Psalms, right? Ecclesiastes. Proverbs, Jobs, and Ecclesiastes are all considered wisdom literature. They're written so that not as promises necessarily, they're not guarantees, they're not covenants, but they capture life lived in God's world, given what God has said about himself and about his people. And so when you have Song of Songs, it is wisdom in the sense that this is a paradigm, a picture of how God designed love. Very different from 1 Kings chapter 11, especially verses 1 through 2. So when you put these two together, you then learn that wise love is three different things. You could say there are three different characteristics of what wise or biblical love, what that looks like. Based off of both the story of Scripture, stories found in Scripture, and also the Song of Songs. And that's this. That wise love is monotheistic, monogamous, and embodied. Monotheistic, monogamous, and embodied. It's got to be monotheistic. And we learn that from the story of Solomon. Do you still have Deuteronomy chapter 17 bookmarked? God gave the kings a job description, especially of what not to do. And King Solomon, marrying foreign women as wives, is exactly what he shouldn't have done. And different parts of Exodus and Deuteronomy also mention foreigners. Now, this is an ancient Near Eastern understanding of foreigners. It's not what we as modern folks understand foreigners in, especially when you think about the border down south or immigrants from different nation states here, right? You have to set yourself into the original context to understand the reason why the foreigners were a danger, people were not permitted to marry foreigners at that time. It's because they would bring the temptation to follow another god. Solomon, by bringing on not just one, but many different kinds of wives, also got the package, got the religious package as a part of those marriage deals. And Scripture tells us his heart was turned away from the one true living God. He became a polytheist as opposed to a monotheist. And there's a lesson for us to learn from that, from this picture of Solomon, in that you don't have to be an atheist to dishonor and disobey God. You can be a Christian and still be a pagan. You can still confess the one true living God and act in a way as if certain parts of God's word is true, but certain parts I conveniently ignore because there are more relevant or efficient or more helpful ideas that I can live by, that I can abide by. You don't have to be an atheist to dishonor God and disobey him. Right? And then it's also, not only is it wise love is monotheist, it is monogamous. There's only one true and living God. And where your heart is in relationship to God and what he wants of you will get lived out in a particular area of your life, and that is your desires. Song of Songs is used and is read at weddings. In the Jewish tradition today, it's read at Passover. Right? It is used to talk about what life ought to be like within marriage between one man and one woman, and how marriage and physical intimacy is a beautiful, wonderful, amazing gift of God. And that God would commit himself, right, to have someone write poetry about it and has been canonized in Scripture. It is for us. In other words, our religion is an embodied religion. God cares about our bodies and how we steward our bodies, our sexuality, our passions, and more deeper than just our behavior, but our affections, who we love, and more importantly, how we love makes all the difference. A monogamous, monotheistic, embodied marriage points to the mystery of Jesus Christ and his bride, to quote Apostle Paul. That gift of physical intimacy was a gift. It is a gift. But it's got to be used in the right way. And today is not a sermon on sexuality or, you know, dating parameters, or it's not marriage counseling sermon. That's not the point for today. The point for today is to go even deeper. The point of today is to get to your heart, the core of your being, to ask the first question of the X-ray questions here. What do you love? Or what do you hate? And then related to that is, what do you want? What do you desire, crave, lust, and wish for? What desires do you serve and obey? And then even related to that, all these questions serve as different ways to diagnose that heart. Now, I wonder if Solomon had these questions, whether or not it would have helped him diagnose his heart before it turned away from the Lord. And then finally, whom must you please? Because if you love a particular person or a particular fantasy or a particular dream, right, then you will naturally want to please that person. Or you're constantly thinking about what that person has to say, what their opinion of you is. From whom do you desire approval from? And on the other side of the term, other side of the coin is, well, whose rejection do you fear? Whose love and approval do you need? The point is this. Within God's design and parameters of a monotheistic and monogamous religion that marriage points to, or the ideal marriage points to, it will show you whether or not your heart is in the right place in worshiping and honor God. How you behave, what you say, and how you say it, whether in person or digitally online, will reflect where your commitment and allegiances are in your heart. So here's the subtle and scary part about sin. Physical intimacy within marriage is a gift from God. Praise the Lord. Other gifts of God include, according to Solomon's story, wealth and power and influence, fame. God gave him these things, including wisdom, because he honored the Lord. And then God prospered him. He became well known. Happy, happy are your men, says Queen of Sheba. Happy are your servants who continue to stand before you and hear your wisdom. God has shown favor. God answered prayers. When God answers prayers to bless Solomon, that became the temptation to sin. You can be so wise in your own eyes. You can have all the resources to get whatever you want and believe that because God has answered your prayer, that you have been anointed. You've been blessed to the point where you're so smart that you start ignoring different parts of God's word. That's the subtlety and danger of prosperity and blessing in your life. As if smooth sailing, ease, and all the resources in the world is identical with God's favor in your life. He was gifted wisdom, wealth, power, and influence. And yet, his allegiance was swerved when he started disobeying God by loving what he was not supposed to love. You're given God's gift, and you believe that you are honoring God's purposes, for he was king. He was doing his job. But how you do your job to honor God and glorify God makes all the difference. The temptation is, I can make an exception. God has blessed me. I think I'm exercising my wisdom by pursuing things more efficiently and more expediently. Because earlier on, Solomon said that, or the author about writing about Solomon, his first foreign wife, Pharaoh's daughter, it was for a political alliance. That's shrewd. That's wise. But that's a wisdom that does not honor God. He was doing what was evil in the sight of God. The Song of Songs, when contrasted, if we're going to tie Song of Songs to Solomon, helps show you it's the mirror by which Solomon ought to have looked at. Or the standard. Is God's word your mirror, as it says in James, where the book is all about what? Wisdom. Is God's word, or is your mirror, your standard by which you're assessing what it is you love, what you care about, is it the algorithms of social media? Or other people? Or is it God's word? What has I don't have a specific application in that this is what you should do, this is how you should change, right? The obvious ones include, especially when speaking about Song of Songs, is if you're not living a life that's consistent with God's ethics on sex and relationships and marriage, you need to check where your allegiance is and ask, is God's word enough? Or am I wiser than God? That's the obvious one. But the less obvious one is this, is to handle with care these questions, these x-ray questions, or maybe it's not x-ray. Maybe for you it might feel like an MRI or a CAT scan where you might feel like claustrophobic, like Pastor Howard, like all these questions are really, really difficult. I actually don't know how to answer these questions. Ask someone. That would be wise, as it says in Proverbs. You need counsel in your life. And if you don't have that, maybe that be your application. For you to invite someone into your life in such a way that they would know you and have the courage and the love and care for you enough to tell you what you're doing wrong or what you're doing is foolish. Or, a little more gently, help you answer these questions, to diagnose where your heart is. We have the Song of Songs, and in light of Song of Songs, Solomon falls short. And even when thinking about how love actually is, love and physical intimacy is practiced in our culture today, and not just in our culture, out there, the statistics show that Christians aren't that much different from the rest of the culture. Things that happen, and as a result, people are hurt, abused, traumatized. Generation after generation, toxicity persists, as it does in the descendants of Solomon. Something spiritual and fundamental in God's design fractures, and people live the consequences generation after generation. But in the fullness of time, in a particular generation, Jesus Christ was born, the descendant of David, who was tempted in very similar ways as Solomon. When the devil caught Jesus in the wilderness and asked him three different things. Three different things that Jesus, as rightful heir and king, already had the rights to. Like Jim said when he preached on Luke 20, on the passage in, I think it was Luke, it's the devil's like the guy up on the Blue Ridge Parkway selling land. It doesn't make any sense. Jesus Christ already had rights to all those things, so where's the temptation? The temptation is how the devil wants Jesus to go about getting it. The way to what is rightfully yours makes all the difference. So with Jesus, he is what the Song of Songs ultimately points to. Jesus Christ is the Lord of Lords. He is the one that pursued his bride in light of her shame, in light of her guilt from sin, the dirt that's on her, not just being tan or dark as the women in Song of Songs was concerned about, self-conscious about, right? But deeply stained from the guilt and corruption of sin. Jesus Christ pursued a bride, a people for himself, not because she was lovely, but in order to make her lovely. The gospel says that his life and all the songs about him is that he would pursue relentlessly to the point of death, even death on the cross. And that the way he did it is exactly the way God intended it to happen, so that he would show his covenant faithfulness to his people. So I pray that as you assess your priorities, the different things that you long for and love, and you see, like me probably, how disordered your loves are, I pray that by being united to Jesus, married to him, that he, like it says in the Apostle Paul, that he, as the husband, would wash you with the water of his word. And that one day, when everything is said and done, and he makes everything right, that we would all be there together at the wedding of the Lamb and his bride. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, you've given us and revealed to us your will. I pray that you would find, that we would find deep satisfaction in knowing that to love you and to love our neighbor is enough. And that your ways might become our ways, so that as beings created in your image, that we would represent you, the one and true living God. Oh God, expose our hearts to the temptations that cause us by our words and deed and our thoughts, as if there were other attractive gods out there. Help us to repent and to turn our hearts to you and find forgiveness and to find delight in us as your image bearers and collectively as your bride. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's stand and sing together to worship him, our God and King.
Your side.
Pray this week you would find that deep stillness in your souls, contented with Jesus Christ himself and all that he has in store for us, a union because you've been united to him with his blood. May you go with the blessing of the Lord. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Go and serve the Lord.